close. I only discover that when I set myself challenges that are beyond my capacity, and then I struggle to meet the challenge that I myself imposed. So the reason I set this particular way of structuring the workshop is that I feel pretty strongly that it would be a big mistake to separate biodynamics from its source and inspiration, from the life and work of Rudolf Steiner. So that's why I'm going to lead into the overview of biodynamics with Rudolf Steiner's life. And I do so not out of some historical interest particularly, but because I have the experience, I wanted to say that Rudolf Steiner is a continuing inspiration and source of insights. It's not that he died and it's over and now we're on into the, you know, grand new future. We are also, but there is actually a continual stream of inspiration that we can connect with if we remember that there's a living source for biodynamics. So that's what I kind of want to introduce you to. Welcome. That's fine. If you can't hear, move forward. So I'm going to start with a story that I heard when I was in university. I went to Boston University for a short time. And I was studying religion. And the religion teacher, that's because I had already met anthroposophy and I wanted to kind of get some kind of perspective on all this. And this wonderful teacher, it's the only thing I remember from his course, was this story. It's amazing how things fade. But he told a story about a pig who had eaten an acorn and thought it was really delicious. And the pig, being a rooting animal, started to root around to try to find more acorns. And he rooted and rooted and dug a big hole and dug a big hole and got himself so tired that eventually he fell in. I can't remember if he died or not, but it was anyway not a good end to the story. And it was all because he didn't look up to discover that the source of the acorn was an oak tree that he was under. And I think that's actually one of the big themes of Rudolf Steiner's agriculture course. It's kind of like, broaden your perspective. Look outside of the usual direction that you expect to find the answers from. So Rudolf Steiner brings that right in the beginning when he talks about the plant and says, we usually look at the plant ever more microscopically to try to understand it, but actually look at the environment of a plant. It's, as we heard this morning, it's the whole night sky, it's all the rhythms of all the moon and the planets and the stars and the sun, and it's the depths of the earth. Where do the roots go? So right towards the center of the earth, that the plant is oriented in the whole universe. That, and he uses the example of the compass. He says, you know, if you get a compass and you want to understand why is the needle pointing that way, you actually will never understand it by just looking at the compass. You only can understand it when you realize there's a magnetic North Pole. And that is the reason why. You have to look at the whole Earth. And that's what he tries to encourage again and again in the agriculture course, that you expand your sense in space. And he goes so far as to say that the whole of nature is interconnected. It's all a unity. And that comes again and again also. So here we have this expansion. I got to hear that with the pig story. It becomes now very to know that, the whole study of ecology is to become awake to the interconnections. But there was Rudolf Steiner in 1924 saying, the whole of nature is connected to itself and to the universe. So there's a second big theme, and that is an evolution in time. So we also have to expand our sense of reality in time. It goes obviously back to when consciousness, welcome, was very, very different. And we heard something about that this morning, that consciousness was actually more in tune with the universe and with nature in a more dreamy way, in a more pictorial way. People knew things, but they knew them, they just knew them. And now we've lost that just knowing, that inner picturing, and instead we've got what you brought from astrology to astronomy, or all the hard sciences. So we see things very clearly with our senses, or if not, we get glasses and hearing aids, whatever we need, because that's what we want, is sharp sense perception and clear intellectual thinking. Both of those things weren't present to the same degree in ancient times. Rudolf Steiner takes it a step further by saying that even nature has changed. And that's a big step. We're used to thinking of climate change as being sort of all our fault, which largely it is. But Rudolf Steiner said that the changes, there are changes in nature from those ancient times as well. And that basically the old gifts, the old healings and traditional medicines, all those old ways which we treasure and love to learn about won't suffice anymore because nature is different. And that we're going to have to find a new kind of knowing in order to solve the problems that we have now and particularly work with the land. So my question to you, if you haven't thought about it, is who was Rudolf Steiner and how does he dare say such a thing? I mean, by what authority is he saying consciousness has changed, the earth is changing, you can't go back? Right? That's a big deal. So that's why I wanted to tell you about Rudolf Steiner, because he's also the originator of biodynamics, and so why the heck should we listen to him? I mean, I don't know. I'm not a person who just takes things on anybody's authority, so I think it's a worthwhile question to explore who is this person? Are you with me? Ready to go there? So, this person, Rudolf Steiner, was born in 1861, not last century, but the century before, into a very poor family. His father was a railroad worker. By the way, I'm going to leave out tons. I could tell you Rudolf Steiner's life story in 3 hours and still have more. I'm going to do it short. his father was a free thinker. So this was the height of materialism. We think we're in the height of materialism. It was actually worse then, because they were, a lot of people were just dissing the whole past and dogma and all that, and science was the great new thing. Now we're kind of past that. We're looking beyond. But that was really the grip. And his father was right into it. High tech at that time was the railroad. So Rudolf Steiner grew up at the railroad station, where his father was the station master. He had to work long hours, and yet he was at a very rural outpost of the railway. So he was really out there and in view of the Austrian Alps, and in a very beautiful natural setting, and yet right there at the railroad station. He was connected to the local peasants. He remembers walking. They called him Rudolf, and they talked to him just like a normal person. He remembered that they didn't treat him like a child. The most distinctive thing about Rudolf Steiner in his childhood was that starting around the age of 7, he began to have inner experiences, a little bit like what I described to you before, inner picturing. So this was unusual. He pretty soon figured out that these inner experiences that he was having were not shared by his parents or the people around him, and that it wasn't okay to talk about it. So he divided the world into what he called the seen world, which is how we see each other this way, and the unseen world. And that unseen world would appear to him as a more vivid reality than the seen world. So already as a child, both when he looked into nature and when he interacted with other human beings. That was lonely. You can imagine to have nobody who understood it or, he could talk to about it. He went to, for those who are interested, he did garden chores. They grew a garden, they had goats. He did things. They went scavenging in the forest for berries and things. So he was very connected to nature as a child. When he went to school, one of his teachers took an interest in him, and he saw on the desk of this teacher a book on geometry. And he asked if he could borrow it. He was 10. So he borrowed the book, and he says in his autobiography that reading this book gave him the first experience of happiness he ever had. Odd. But why do you think that was? It's because other people were taking seriously ideas that don't exist physically. The Pythagorean theorem, it's a purely mental reality. It's something, even the idea of a triangle. There, for the first time, he was meeting something around him that corresponded to his inner life and that other people took seriously. It became a kind of bridge, a common language. And it was a justification for this inner world that for him was so real. So he went, fast forwarding. He took a test when he was 11 in school, and he must have done well. So his father was thrilled. And his idea was, this boy is going to go far. He's going to have a position in the railroad. That's what his father thought. So his father sent him to the Realschule. In Europe, there's two tracks of education. And at the age of 12, you go one or the other. The one is the gymnasium, and that's like a liberal arts high school. And the other is called Realschule, more technical education. So he was sent to the technical school early because his father was so proud of him. It was very stressful for him. He actually struggled for a year and a half just because he had skipped a year. But he caught up with himself. And he describes how boring school was and how nothing that he was learning helped him with his real burning questions. And his really most burning question was, how do I build a bridge between the unseen world and the seen world? How do I prove to somebody that there's a reality to what I experience, we would call the spirit. So, he found in the bookstore window a copy of a book with a title that struck him. It's called The Critique of Pure Reason. So now he's 16. The Critique of Pure Reason. Anybody know who wrote that one?
Kant.
Immanuel Kant. It's one of the most dry philosophical texts you can possibly imagine. What a disaster. He's saved up his money, I should tell you. He was a tutor. His teachers gave him other students to tutor, and he brought the money home to his father. And so he saved a little and bought this book. Then, of course, he had no time to read it, because he actually lived an hour and a half away from his high school. It was in the next town. And so his solution was to cut up Critique of Pure Reason and lay it inside his history book at school and read it, because the teacher just taught out of a book. And so he would appear to be diligently reading, and he was poring over this thing. Anyway, he read that only to discover that Immanuel Kant had the complete opposite view from what he was hoping it would show. And Kant says, you can never know anything. It's really, there's the things in themselves, whether it's you or the steps, it doesn't matter, I can know it. I'm stuck in my own projection of myself. This is educated philosophy less than 101. Anyway, it's a dualistic philosophy. It basically says there's me and everything else. And that there's no bridge. So Rudolf Steiner learned from that, not that he was wrong, but that he was going to have to develop his own philosophy. If that was the pinnacle of philosophy, he was going to have to build that bridge himself. This is a 16, 17-year-old boy. But he knew that that was going to be his task. He taught himself history, Greek, Latin. He was bored by his curriculum. So that stood him in good stead, because later when he continued tutoring in university level, he already had done both the gymnasium and the Realschule curriculum. So he graduated. The teachers had to give him a new grade. There was no grade. The highest grade was excellent in his high school. They gave him outstanding. There was nobody else who had had that before, but they felt they had to do something to recognize him. And then he went to the Vienna Technical College, which is kind of like the MIT of Austria at that time. It was a scientific technical college. He studied science and math. He was still tutoring. His parents moved their railway position. They had a deal with the railway that when his son was going to college, they would move closer to Vienna so he could go on the train. You might think this was a very nerdy kind of guy who didn't relate to other people. It's actually not true. He was very social. He was totally interested in culture, music, theater. He was just all over the place. He was fascinated by the cultural life of Vienna, and people loved to talk to him. He was such a good listener. And they told him their love life, all the troubles that they had. Anyway, that's nice to know. again, he was bored with the curriculum at the technical school. He figured out he could teach himself math from the textbook. He had to keep his grades up to keep the scholarship going. But he was very interested in philosophy, so he would literally go across town. I've been to Vienna. I actually wanted to see these places, so I know what it means when I say he ran across town. The university and the technical college are at the opposite ends of the town. He would go across in the math class time to go hear famous philosophers giving lectures at the university. He also got permission to study anatomy and optics. He bought with his tutoring money, he bought instruments. He had a hunch that the Newton's theory of optics was not as truthful as Goethe's, and he made the experiments, and he satisfied himself that was true. He was very happy with the study of space, that at what we call, they call it synthetic geometry, what we would call projective geometry, that this idea that if you go infinitely in one direction, it comes back from the other side. I don't know if you've ever done projective geometry. That's something you can study anywhere. That was good. He was very pleased with it. But he said nobody was studying the riddle of time. So normally we think, you know, kind of time marches on, right? And what didn't happen doesn't exist yet, because it didn't happen yet. But we all know that we can dream about something before it happens. Yeah? There could be no such thing as prophecy or kind of that sense of the future, which we probably everybody in this room has, without another stream of time. How is it possible that you know something that didn't happen yet? And so he was aware of another stream of time that comes from the future, that meets the stream of time that comes from the past. And that is actually, I'm just going to interject here. Sometimes people say, oh God, Rudolf Steiner, you know, that's old, that's 100 years old now, and it must be outdated, right? Waldorf education, biodynamics, now we're so much smarter, right? So we wouldn't need that. But it's amazing to me how, certainly in both biodynamics and Waldorf education, it is so future-bearing. It's answering problems that they barely had then. We have them now. Now we have solutions that he was drawing from this future source of time. That's why it's so helpful.
Relevant.
All right. He had two special teachers at that time. Well, three. One was a professor, Carl Julius Schroeder. German speakers. He was a Goethe scholar. He was like a token humanities teacher at a technical college. You didn't have to go to his classes. He was just like available. And Rudolf Steiner formed a deep relationship with him and appreciated his wisdom. And often he was the only person who came to the class. So they would just meet in his professor's office, and the professor invited him to his home. He called him his fatherly friend. So this man played a great role in his destiny later on. The other person was on the train going to and from Vienna. He would see this herb gatherer who would come into town with a sack of medicinal herbs on his back and go to the different pharmacies and sell them so they could make medicine out of them. And his name was Felix Kogutsky. And so Rudolf Steiner befriended this man on the train, and from the way Felix was speaking, he realized, oh my God, this man sees too. That was the first time he ever met another human being who also had this inner vision. And so they became real friends, and Rudolf Steiner was invited to his home, and there he introduced him to nature in a much more refined way, taught him how to perceive the medicinal properties of plants, how to experience the elemental beings in nature, and really educated him further in his way of seeing nature. Felix, and also the stars, and everybody else thought he was a crackpot, you could imagine, because he would just talk about, oh, you know, this mineral relates to this, you know, planet, and people didn't know what to make of it. And in the mystery dramas that Rudolf Steiner wrote, there's a character called Felix, who is modeled after this man. Anyway, Felix introduced Rudolf Steiner to someone whose name I don't know, and I don't think anybody knows it. Rudolf Steiner just called him his master.
His friend.
So around the age of 21, Rudolf Steiner met his master, and I'll just say a couple of words. There's not a lot that's known, but at the end of the sort of couple of months where they worked intensively together, he asked this man, how can I overcome the dragon of materialism? And the answer was, you'll have to learn to creep inside its skin. So you're not going to just eat it from the outside. It's not going to be affected by that. You're going to have to understand it, really get it. What is this materialism? What is its purpose? What is there? And then his other question was, what do I do about the bull of public opinion? And the answer was, take it by the horns. So already in his early 20s, Rudolf Steiner knew that he was going to be unpopular, as we would say. At the end of that period of teaching, the teacher said, I have shown you who you are, now go and be yourself. So he then,
It's only 2 o'clock.
I know, I have a lot to go. He created his own philosophy by the time he was finished with college. He called it objective idealism. And I just want to give you that in 2 sentences. Rudolf Steiner will forgive me for this, but I'm sure. He said, you basically, just to know anything, you have to have a kind of a starting point. And the starting point is your own thinking. So I can know my own thinking, regardless of whether it's right or wrong, with the same clarity that I can know a mathematical problem and solution. I know what I thought. Yeah? You know what you're thinking right now. That's clear to you. That's a beginning. You know it. Nobody can know that better than you. You have a starting point for knowing something, for sure. And the second big element is that we have physical senses, and there are also spiritual senses. But they all perceive the same reality. It's not another world, the spiritual world. It's the spiritual dimension of the same world that you perceive with your senses. So, in contrast to Kant, who had a dualistic philosophy, whereas there's you and then there's everything outside of you, Rudolf Steiner's philosophy was monistic. It's one world. We are in the same world, physically and spiritually. Yeah? Okay. There was a new publication that was coming out of all of German literature, and Schröer was given the honor of editing all of Goethe's works. Only problem was he didn't know anything about the scientific works. And so he suggested to the editor of this big
project,
publication, that Rudolf Steiner, his student, would be the best one to edit